One day Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross every day and follow me." Jesus was clear that to follow him required total commitment, and many chose to turn away. So as we think about that, think about, is it a waste to give your life in service to Jesus Christ? Many of you in here have done hours and hours and a host of work at the church, fixing up the buildings, cutting the grass, preparing meals, serving on a committee, being a teacher, singing in the choir, all the things that a church does, you're involved in that, and you spend hours and hours doing that. Was that a waste or not? It may be that when we spend those hours, that it's actually not a waste, but our gift of thanksgiving back to God for what he's done in our heart and how he's changed our lives. John wrote about Mary. And in this passage, he wrote that Mary gave her all. Apparently, the family of Lazarus was not a very wealthy family, probably a middle-class family. They didn't have servants. They had to do the work themselves. Martha was often found in the kitchen working, serving. She was serving this meal. And so they weren't a very wealthy family. And they had one item that was worth a great deal of money. And it was given to Jesus. Mary is an example to follow. In Matthew 26, Jesus said, wherever this gospel is preached throughout the world, what Mary has done will also be told in memory of her. And so Jesus elevated what she did to a status of an example. Her actions are a symbol of what followers do. We give our all to Jesus. Apparently, all the disciples were critical of Mary's extravagant anointing. Judas voiced it, but they were all in agreement. Nobody said anything against what Judas did except Jesus. The family was not very wealthy. They didn't have a lot that they could give, but Mary wanted to give what they could, to give it all. Every penny mattered to them. And she had this container worth 300 pence of ointment and poured the whole thing on Jesus' head and feet. So was it a waste of ointment? So what is a waste? A waste is a little extra, more than you need. When the gospel is preached, people should come to him and waste themselves on him. Give of themselves more than what is needed. And so we don't just do what's necessary, we do more than what's necessary as we serve Jesus. And it's not a waste. Followers of Jesus give more. There was a missionary once that gave his life to missions and returned at the end of his career to his hometown. His health was gone. He didn't have much to show for his life of being a missionary in physical ways, monetary ways. And he ran into one of his old professors who taught him. And the professor looked at him, and the professor was disappointed. He said, "When you were in school, we had high hopes for you. We thought you'd really achieve great things in this life. And look, this is all you are." And he said his first response is he almost wanted to sit down and cry because he thought about the opportunity he had when he graduated from the school. He was a top of his class. He was in the law, and he could have done great things in this world and made it a lot of money and had nice possessions. He probably would have still had his health had he stayed in that profession. And he said at first he was a little bit disappointed with himself, but then it was like the Holy Spirit spoke to him. And his second thought was, what a better way to live a life than to pour it out for Jesus Christ. God's glory was in that lifestyle for him. And he went away thinking how proud he was to be able to give his life in service of the Lord Jesus Christ. If the Lord is worthy, then how can it be a waste? If the Lord is worthy, how can it be a waste that we spend so many hours doing church work? You know, we've heard in recent years people that will sue a church to get their tithe offerings back. And how terrible that is. If the Lord's worthy, it's not a waste. It's not frivolous giving. It's not giving something that's wrong. What the world says about this doesn't matter. the world may criticize. I've heard people talk about how much somebody will give if they give a tithe, and that's what the Lord asks us to do. And if you add it up and you dwell on it, you think, well, that's a lot of money to be given to anybody. And you may be tempted by the tempter not to give it. But when you think about how worthy Jesus is and what he did for us and how thankful we are, as the thanksgivings we just shared, he's worthy of that and so much more. And so we don't just stop at tithes. We give our tithes, and then we give our offerings, and we give our time, we give our resources, we give our influence, we give everything we can, because our Savior is worthy of that. The Lord said it is a good work. Every true work is not done for the poor. Every true work is done unto me. And sometimes we get it confused, and we do what others can see, and we forget that it's about doing for the Lord. That's what's important first. He said, don't neglect the poor, but he's first. We live for Jesus first, and he helps us know how to do for those who need our help. Nothing was too good for Jesus. It's not a waste. In approving Mary's action at Bethany, Jesus was laying the thing that's a basis for all service, and that is pour out all you have, your very self, your very best unto Jesus, and that's enough. The first question is not, do we have poor? The first question is, how can we honor our Savior? Jesus is worthy for us to devote all we are and all we have to him. Our motivation for such an action is that Jesus is worthy. And that's what motivates us to keep going back and keep giving and keep giving even more, because Jesus is worthy of all that we can give. The world teaches, assert yourself. Look out for number one. Have it your way. If you don't look out for you, nobody else will. That's what the world teaches. That's from Satan himself. That's what he wants us to start thinking. Jesus says, just give to him. And he'll show us how to give, and he'll bless what we give. What's wasted is when we spend it on ourselves. When we give to Jesus, it's invested. Jesus contrasts the worldly view by praising Mary, who gave all she had. So I want to look and consider this morning some aspects of giving yourself completely to Christ. Or another way of looking at it is, what is the cost of discipleship? Is it worth it? What will it cost you? And first of all, to be a disciple costs financially. It takes money to do things. And keep in mind, it cost not to do for Jesus too. Life itself cost. The pure nard, or the perfume that Mary put on Jesus' feet, came from far north of India. It was imported at a great cost. It was very expensive. Judas estimated that it could have been sold for 300 denarii. I don't know why he knew so much about perfume, but he suggested it could be sold for 300 denarii. A denarii would be a day's wage. 300 would be about a year. So if you multiply that, and we'll say $10 an hour just for the ease of multiplication, and we could easily come up with about $24,000 for this perfume, probably about 12 ounces of perfume. That's pretty expensive. Even in today's world, that's very expensive. Another way of looking at it, that was probably their nest egg for retirement. And when Lazarus died, they probably had considered selling that to live on for several years. It was their 401k that was cashed out and given to Jesus. The motivation may have been that Jesus gave them their brother back, the breadwinner, the one to take care of them. It may have just been their love for Jesus. But Mary took the whole thing and opened it and poured it on Jesus' head and feet and anointed him. And Jesus said she was saving this for his burial. And if you look at the end of the story, Nicodemus helped bury Jesus, and he put some spices and things, about 75 pounds, with the body of Jesus. But when Mary went to the tomb on that Sunday morning to anoint the body, he was gone. The only one who anointed the body of Jesus was Mary, and she did it before he was in the grave because she was willing to give. In the hymn, "I Survey the Wondrous Cross," Isaac Watts wrote the words, "Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Mary gave all she had because she knew Jesus was worth it. Think about your own giving, not only money, your tithes, your offerings, but your time and all you do. Does it reflect how you really think about Jesus? Or maybe it does reflect what you think about Jesus. And is that all you think about Jesus? Think about what you give to Jesus. Secondly, to be a disciple costs socially. This deals with pride. What will people think? What will they say if I'm at church all the time? What will they say if I bring up the name of Jesus? What will they say if I have a prayer in a restaurant? I remember when I was at my first church and I was real young, we went to a restaurant with all the family, and there were some other people there. It was in Minden Hall at the Round Table, if you ever know, ever been there. And so just all kind of people were sitting around that big old huge round table. And there were already people there. And the thought occurred to me to say a prayer. But I thought, well, these other people are there and it will disturb them. And so I decided I just wouldn't do it. And about that time, one of the people already there said, "Would y'all like to join us in a blessing for our meal?" I was somewhat embarrassed. But I learned a lesson, and it's never been a problem since then. Because I learned it doesn't matter where you are. It's not about pride. It doesn't matter what others think. You give honor to Jesus Christ. And so it deals with pride, what people will think. One time when our children were young and they were playing t-ball, our oldest was playing t-ball many years ago. They had games on Wednesday night. And so I had gone to the church to have meetings and get ready and stuff like that, and took them to the game. And they could play until church time. And then if they were on the field, she'd call them off the field. It's time for church. And as she left, others would say, "I wish I could do that." But their pride wouldn't allow them to do it. They were worried about work, wouldn't allow them to do it. Their influence in the community wouldn't allow them to do it. And so to be a disciple costs socially. Are you willing to put Jesus ahead of all other things? Matthew and Mark record that Mary anointed Jesus' head. John records that Mary anointed Jesus' feet. She probably anointed both, and so there's no contradiction there. But when she anointed Jesus' feet, she undid her hair and she dried his feet with her hair. It was out of the social norm for a proper woman to undo her hair in public like that in front of other people, particularly men. But she did out of her devotion for Jesus. She wasn't thinking about what people would say or think. It embarrassed, apparently, the disciples in seeing that because it was such an act of humility. When she took out the perfume to put on Jesus' feet, she knew the value of it. And she thought about she would anoint Jesus' feet. She didn't have any second thought saying, "Well, maybe I ought not to." She did it because of her love for Jesus. In the Old Testament, when talking about giving, it's the principle of the thought, the figure that comes to mind is what you are to give. Not second-guessing it, say, "Well, that's too much." We're to give what the Lord puts on our mind. And she gave without reserve. She gave to Jesus. She wiped his feet with her hair. It was humiliating to wipe his feet. And so she gave all her pride to Jesus. In humility, she accepted Jesus and did for him. And number three, to be a disciple costs you some criticism. Now, this is one of the saddest categories because, unfortunately, some of our loudest critics are church members. Are you willing to put your reputation on the line to be committed to Jesus? It doesn't matter what people think or say. And it is often church members because church members get in a rut. Church members have a standard they get used to, and they want it to stay right there. And when somebody comes in and moves the benchmark to be more committed to Jesus, some people don't like that, and they will criticize one who does that. And they want them to move that benchmark back to where they were accustomed to. They'll serve at this level, but they don't want to serve at a higher level. This is all they want to do for Jesus. And so, sadly, A lot of the criticism is from church members. Are you willing to do that higher level anyway, even though there are critics? When we need to spend money to do ministry, you know what the first question is always asked? Well, how much does that cost? One day I'm going to be so shocked and I'm going to fall out and I'm going to totally faint away. Somebody's going to say, well, how many people do you think we can win to the Lord if we do that? As the first question. And I'm just going to totally pass out. Because it's always, how much does it cost? We're worried about the money. There's another truth to that also. The one that asks about spending money is the one that's not giving. They don't know where any more is coming from. Those who are giving, tithing and giving offers, they know there's plenty of money coming in because they're giving it. And they don't mind spending it for the Lord. There's a missionary once that was called to the South Sea Islands where there were cannibals. But he was called of the Lord to go and serve there. And he prepared and he made his way to get ready to go there. And there was an older man in the church that was critical of him and said, you know, if you go there, you're going to get eaten by cannibals. He's critical all the way through the process. And finally, the young man, he had just heard this man say this and criticized him all the way through. He said, well, sir, it won't be too many more years. You're going to be laid in the grave and worms are going to eat your body. I don't care if it's worms that eat me or cannibals that eat me. When the day comes, the Lord raises us up, we both have a perfect body. And he went to serve the Lord. So, this is where we get to. Our concern needs to be, is the Lord satisfied? Is the Lord satisfied with you? Is the Lord satisfied with your level of giving, your level of serving, your level of studying the Bible to be prepared, your level of witnessing, sharing, encouraging? Is the Lord satisfied with your life? You could ask this question, has my life pleased the Lord? That's what the whole message is about today. Where are you with the Lord? We say we're thankful, but does our life reflect it or just our words? I'm thankful as long as the Lord is blessing and blessing and heaping blessings upon me. I'm so thankful for all my blessings that I get. But am I used of the Lord to be a blessing to somebody else? Do I let the Lord use my resources to help bless someone else? Do I let the Lord use my life to be a blessing to somebody else? My words of encouragement, do I let the Lord use those to be a blessing to somebody else? Especially somebody else that can never return the favor. Somebody that's not of my social status that I think I am. Or a stranger. Or somebody of another class. Or somebody of another educational level. Has my life pleased the Lord? When we see Mary in Scripture, we see her often at the feet of Jesus. She wanted to be taught. She wanted to learn. She was hanging on every word that he said, and she was applying it in her heart. She's interested in learning spiritual truths. She wanted to know more. She was probably one of the most intimate people with Jesus as far as the teaching and the relationship they had and wanting to be a part of what Jesus was. Mary didn't second guess the costly ointment. She anointed Jesus' feet. She didn't worry about those who were watching. She didn't care who saw her pour out the ointment. She didn't care if she was criticized. She wanted to anoint Jesus' feet. When we're devoted to Jesus, our actions will reflect our love for him. And so do you love Jesus? You love him more now than you did last week and 20 years ago and the day you were saved. You love him more now. And is it reflected in your life, in your actions, in your service? In John 12:11, the people say of you, on account of Lazarus, many people came to know Jesus. How about if we change that around and put your name there instead of Lazarus? On account of your name, many people believe in Jesus. Could that be said? On account of Steve, many people have come to know Jesus. On account of you, many people have come to know Jesus. Can that be said about you? Is that a truth? None of this world's accolades or accomplishments will follow us in eternity, but what we do out of faith for Jesus will be our reward in heaven. And what we do with that reward is I don't put mine down and say, well, look, my reward's bigger than yours. That's not what we're going to do. That doesn't happen in heaven. We take our reward, we lay it at the master's feet. We lay it at Jesus' feet. That's our gift we take to him. And so if you back it up, your faith that you exercise daily is your gift to Jesus every day. How is your faith? Are you trusting in Jesus? You serving Jesus? Are you loving him? During the week of Thanksgiving, are you truly thankful for the love the Lord has for you? He loved you so much, he died for you. And will you let your love for him, your gratitude for that salvation, be expressed in how you love others? Let's give our lives to him because we are grateful.
In his honor, ever. Stay. whose hand that guides us, hidden in his healing wings. Day by day his love provides us every good and perfect thing. In thanksgiving let us praise him, in thanksgiving.